Hi, I'm Kumi Taguchi. Tonight on Insight, religion, sex and politics. Yes, every topic we're not meant to discuss around the dinner table.
My father once said that a rebellious son should be stoned to death.
I just told her I'm gay.
How did you make that decision to cut off contact with your parents?
Well, I think it was actually made for me.
For my daughter to associate with a gender apostate as myself is dangerous territory to go into.
How did you feel about your son's shift in values?
It was very hard to take.
I realised that there were some really troubling things about God. His morals are questionable.
Pole dancing, it's like being a kid. We're running out on the playground, swinging and just playing. I've been pole dancing for about 10 years and I currently teach a class in Christchurch. Hi, I'm Kurt, a software developer, biomedical engineer and sometime pole dancer. Barn door backwards and get a nice pinch. And transition. I grew up in a very conservative, faith-based Christian household with a very authoritarian father. If I had mentioned an interest in pole dancing to my parents when I was a kid, I believe I would have been shut down very quickly. Pole's definitely not the only thing in my life that conservative people would feel some disapproval of. When I'm here in the studio, I feel the most free to be able to just express myself with people that are just one of the most loving and supportive communities I know. Since my childhood, my values have changed a lot. As a result of having differences of opinion, I've often found myself more ostracized and that I do need to be very forward in my willingness to speak up if I don't want to have my voice erased.
Kurt, what's been the cost of defending and changing your values, as you say, so that your voice is not erased?
I was disowned by my parents for a total of 16 years of my adult life. Pretty much out of a sense of my father taking it that I was challenging his authority.
Growing up in that conservative home with your father, what values were you raised with?
Very judgmental and restrictive of any kind of social difference, or as they would refer to it, deviance. In fact, to the point where with me just not understanding why I was in trouble so often, my father once, in an effort to try and pressure me straight, once said that a rebellious son should be stoned to death.
When did you start challenging those beliefs?
The real starting spark for that was feeling like I needed to protect others around me, particularly my mother. When I ended up challenging my father one day when I was about 14, 15, and he took that very strongly to just be this is an absolutely his authority issue, to the point where he threw me out of the house because I wouldn't back down, but I couldn't apologise for wanting to protect my mother.
So at 14, you were effectively kicked out of home?
Yes.
Did that incident change you?
It was the start of a loss of fear, and that led to my loss of religion.
How would you describe your values or beliefs today?
Currently, I identify as polyamorous. I have dated multiple people at once, ethically and I found that to be a beautiful reduction of jealousy and the support that can be available. I've had a boyfriend, I've got a trans kid. I'm just trying to manage looking after childcare and everything. I really feel like I'm able to engage in thinking and philosophizing. I feel like I've opened my mind a lot.
Alex, in 2008, you moved to Australia from China as a 17-year-old. What was behind that move?
I think when I was growing up in China, there's nowhere to find information. And I just always knew I was different.
And you knew you were different in what way?
I guess, you know, when I was growing up, you know, going through high school, I started to notice that I probably attracted to boys rather than girls, you know. I remember as far as I can, when I was growing up, like, as I always been, you know, picked on being feminine, even when I was 5 or 6 years old. I just, yeah, always stood out.
What were some of the challenges you faced in coming to terms with your sexuality?
I guess the lack of knowledge, really. There's no information for me to find out. Mm. And when I was growing up, I guess that was the start of the internet. And the available information in Chinese was quite scarce, I suppose. Yeah.
How would you describe your relationships with your parents growing up?
We were really close. My dad is a pilot, so he was away a lot. And my mom and I, we grew up very close, spent a lot of time together. Sometimes I'd say maybe too close, too close for comfort, yeah.
Did you ever think about not coming out to them?
Strangely, I kind of knew quite strongly of who I am. I think deep down inside, I always just know it's a matter of time. When will be the right time to come out to my family?
There was a moment in 2012 when you needed to call your mum.
Yes.
What did you say to her?
I just told her I'm gay and this is life I've been living and I'm enjoying. This is who I am and, you know, I'm hoping she would accept who I am. I think vaguely that's what I said to her. Yep.
Where you're Alex's mum joining us from Chengdu in China. What was that phone call like for you when Alex told you that he was gay?
其实当时实际上我真的是完全不能够理解的，而且我是完全想象不到的。 所以当时我只是听到儿子在里边用哭泣的声音跟我讲，所以每当我那个时候，他就是因为他从来我没有听到过他那么委屈，他说有一个秘密压着他很多很多年，他说妈妈，我一定要说出来，他就讲了同性恋三个字。那当时实际上我自己的感历。 没有什么理解，也没有什么，但是我听到了以后，其实当时就是一个很大的一个问题。但是我知道，但是儿子说了这个以后，他接下来的一句话就是跟我讲，说这个世界上只要是爸爸妈妈接你们接受了我，我就是这个世界上最幸福的人。
Zai, you're Alex's father. You accepted your son's sexuality straight away. Why?
我接受儿子是基于这样的原因。一个呢，就是我对同性恋这个知识的了解。我认为同性恋这个群体呢，它是一个客观的存在，理解和支持他们。 是因为他们是一个少数的群体，他们和其他人会有同等的权利，所以说呢，支持他们是应该的。第二个呢，是出于对孩子的爱，因为我们跟孩子在一起生活，18年，我们了解自己的孩子，他们是。 善良的、友爱的，而且是积极向上的。我个人认为，接纳孩子的性取向，是对他个人人格的尊重，这是也是父母的这个责任。
Wei, why do you think it was harder for you to accept?
其实和我的生长环境有很大关系，因为我父亲是一个职业军人。 我从小是在大院里生，大院里长，然后我的周围的环境，而且我们是一个军人的世家，我的这一辈，就是我的姐姐，然后我的家人，就是我们家的姐夫、妹夫和我先生，全部都是军人，就是说。 这个环境就是说它是一个在我的从小的经历的这个生活的环境，它是一个很正统的，很一个很正向的这么样这样的一个环境下长大。那所以说呢，我就是觉得，同性恋，另外我是60后。 我是60后，60年代初生的，那个时候的，就是说在我生长的那个年代的时候，那个同性恋是以罪来定，那就是我记忆当中他们就叫做流氓罪，叫做一种就是一种很不好的就是。
How did you feel when your husband accepted your son's sexuality straight away?
所以我希望他是支持我的，但是我跟他讲的时候，他父亲怎么就接受？但是我也不能理解他父亲，非常生气，我甚至有一种愤怒，而且我就觉得我完全是没有了一个自我的一种。
Glenn, you're a clinical psychologist with more than 40 years' experience as a family therapist. What are values?
Values are the things that we aspire to, but they also form us, you know, in our personal development and our journeys. But they're kind of formed in conversations with our culture, with our families, and maybe in some sense they have an evolutionary basis too. Because when you think of values like generosity, for example, and empathy, you know, they're good for the species and they kind of give rise to cooperation. I think, you know, values can be studied, but certainly they have great kind of contribution to the people we are and can become, the self that we are.
What shapes our values the most?
Well, certainly our family histories, the families we grew up in. But I guess, you know, the main thing is that our values are formed by the people that we are. They form us in a way, but they also, in some strange way, are kind of influenced by the people that we are and that we have conversations with.
What have you observed are the main values that are fracturing relationships?
We've got a few examples here tonight. But certainly, politics, obviously, sexuality, religion, all of these things. I think any value could have the potential to contribute to a rupture. But as we've seen tonight, I mean, it can also contribute to understanding and growth and empathy and repair.
Isla, your adult child identifies as genderqueer. Your relationship with them broke down 3 years ago. Why?
The relationship broke down over a difference in view about how you resolve conflict and how you communicate in an endeavour to resolve that conflict.
Was the conflict around gender identity?
The conflict was fundamentally around science, evidence-based science, and law, and the mechanisms in our society in which evidence-based science is used or misused to create laws.
When did you last speak to them?
I last spoke to my daughter in 2019, 3 years ago. I did follow up after the last time I saw her with a couple of emails trying to explain that, you know, we can get to a position of acceptance of a diverse perspective on the issues, our beliefs or our understandings, if you like, but I have not had any response.
Is there a sense of perhaps them feeling sort of unsafe around the conversations?
Absolutely. I think this idea of some people feeling unsafe around conversations, in particular questions that you raise, particularly when you're talking about evidence-based medicine, are often raised, this feeling of unsafe. But I think, like with science, science is not an absolute. Science is about testing. It's about testing data, methodology, asking questions, reviewing the new science and building on the science. And I think the same things apply in a familial situation where you have a conflict over what your values are. It's the same sort of issue.
How did you learn that they felt unsafe?
She told me. Mm. But it was the first time that she told me this. I was unaware of that.
You also have a grandchild. Do you have a relationship with them?
No, I have no contact with the grandchild.
Mm. How has this alienation affected you?
In retrospect, there were issues, like most parents have, of unresolved issues from the past. So initially, when I realised that she had made this decision, firstly, I was grief-stricken, absolutely grief-stricken. And physically, you will have heard of the broken heart syndrome, and I had a broken heart. Mm-hmm. And it was physically palpable in my chest. So this went on for about a year. But in that year, I had discussed these issues with a lot of my peers about disengagement from members of family, brothers, sisters, uncles, aunties on this issue. And what I found was that where you're having a conflict with somebody and their response over any discussion of the issues or of an attempt to resolve the conflict is met with, there will be no debate. You have to come to grips with that. Mm. Until such a time as time goes on and people mature or they reflect on their behaviour, their views, what they want out of the relationship potentially in the future. Because familial relationships are not, in my view, something that anybody should actually feel obliged to endure if they feel that they are either harmful or not pleasant.
Janina, you're the mother of a young transgender woman. Can you relate to Isla's experience?
I suppose coming to grips with a child that has a different identity than their biological sex, I did have to go through a process of acceptance and understanding with Emmy, but I, as Emmy's mother, am going to absolutely support Emmy in any way I can. So probably not, I can't relate in the sense that I struggled and fought with that. But yes, it is a process and coming to terms with, yeah.
I don't know how to say this pain I carried almost all my life that's shaped my motivation to try to do good, and it all comes down to just someone being willing to look you in the eye.
Emmy, you're Janina's daughter, you're 18. A few years ago you came out as gay and then non-binary. Last year you came out as transgender. How challenging was all that to deal with as a teenager?
Dealing with all those decisions as a teenager was quite difficult, because I was battling with just many internal questions and my own morals and the morals of people around me to decide. I went through the struggle of trying to figure out if what my identity was without anyone who identified the same way around me alone, and wondering if my parents would ever actually accept that. Even if they had already accepted me twice before, I still was completely uncertain.
So how did your family and friends react?
I came up to my mother first, and she was very accepting, and I'm very grateful that she was. I came out to my dad second, and a lot later, because I was worried as to how he would react, as he is far more religious than my mother. He was also very accepting, if a bit wary at first, because he did not know how to, I guess, react to it. Mm. I came out to my extended family just all at the same time in just a large coming out, and the reaction to that has been more in silence, and I haven't heard anything from them. But according to my dad, he has been defending me from behind. At events, I have been, like family events, I have been spoken to by one or two people, but ultimately ignored, and it made it seem as if I was not there.
You graduated from a Christian high school in Brisbane last year, and for the Year 12 formal, you wanted to wear a dress. How did the school respond to that?
The school was not happy with my decision to do that. They sent me emails to try and get me to come into the head office with the principal to have a one-on-one conversation about me not wearing the dress, which I was, to be honest, scared to go to because of the reputation in amongst the student body of the just higher up staff.
Did you end up being able to wear a dress?
I was eventually able to wear the dress after a week of emailing the school back and forth and contacting lawyers to try and resolve the situation.
Your parents separated when you were 11. Your dad is a teacher at the school. Where did he stand on this?
Multiple times he did ask me whether I would change to comply with the school and try not to, make a big deal about it. Mm. On the day, it seemed like he had just come to terms and just accepted that I was going to go through with it.
Janina, two of your other children attended the same high school as Emmy. Earlier this year, you withdrew them from that school. Why did you do that?
Well, after the we had pushed the school to allow Emmy to wear the dress, it appeared that they had been negotiating a new contract for the school. The new contract had statements in it where they could expel somebody who didn't identify as their biological sex, and it cast people who were gay with bestiality, and it was equating them to be the same thing. Well, the school actually didn't send it to me. They obviously knew how I would respond. But when that contract came out, there is absolutely no way that I would be signing a contract like that and having my children attend a school where that was in writing.
The contract caused a lot of controversy.
Yeah.
What did you think of that?
It was discrimination, 100%.
Did your views and withdrawing your children from the school put you at odds with your family and your ex-husband?
Yes. So I was already at odds with my family over the... I'd removed Emmy from contact with my family. My family has been involved in the Christian schooling movement for a long time, and so has Emmy's. So they see that as a legacy because they have contributed quite significantly as educators. And family in general, there was a reaction from Emmy's paternal grandparents that was concerned that their legacy was going to be destroyed by this controversy and their name attached to that.
And given that family history, that legacy, how did your decision affect your relationship with your parents?
So I haven't been speaking with my parents since a breakdown about 2 years ago, but they certainly weren't supportive of us seeking legal action and pursuing the school in the way that we did.
Mm. Prior to this, your relationship with your parents had already started to fracture. Why was that?
So my family are very conservative evangelical Christians. I've grown up in a very conservative evangelical Christian home. And we've been part of the church my entire life. When I made a decision to pursue politics and ran as a candidate for state and Senate, they were not happy with the type of politics I was interested in. So that was the beginning of a downhill slide there. And then my acceptance, and I did run a women's network within that political party, and we put on a rally for women's issues, which really defended the trans community at the time, and that really affected my parents.
What happened in your mid-30s?
I would say my husband and I at the time were quite involved in the church. We were in ministry, we did worship ministry. We went over to Israel. He had been going off to the Holocaust Museum to do a study there. And I walked around the old city, went and visited all the different areas. I went to a Jewish synagogue with progressive Jews, saw them worshipping God. I walked through the Damascus Gate, met a Muslim man, and we had this incredible conversation about his faith and how he saw God. And I was in the middle of this incredible historical religious place, and I couldn't see these people as worshipping a different God than me. Mm. And I couldn't any longer say that my faith was the only faith. So that was the slide down out of my faith.
Did you leave the church?
I did leave the church, wow. Yes.
Sasha, you come from a long line of Jehovah's Witnesses, three generations on your father's side. You were also a leader in your church. When did you start to doubt your faith?
Yeah, I was born and raised into the Jehovah's Witness religion. I accepted the information that my father raised me with. It wasn't until my mid-30s, though, that I allowed myself to sort of question things. Mm. And it was actually in the process of preparing a part to deliver at the congregation that encouraged us to look at the rich history of the organisation, the Jehovah's Witness organisation, and to appreciate our spiritual heritage. And in the process of researching that, I found out a lot of disturbing things about the origins of the religion and just felt that it wasn't disclosed to us. And it was there that I just allowed myself to slowly research things outside of the approved sources.
In 2012, this is about a year after those doubts began to surface, you came to a conclusion about God. What was it?
When I started to read the Bible without the lens of the religious sort of doctrine, I realised that there were some really troubling things about the personality of God, and that if the God of the Bible is so-called creator, his morals are questionable. And I thought, I'm not perfect, but my morals are better than the God of the Bible. Mm. So I realised that the God of the Bible must just be a human construct. And if that is the God, well, I don't want to worship a God who's okay with those things.
So did you conclude then that God didn't exist?
Yes, that's where I sit now. I'm happy to receive proof if anybody has that. But at this stage, yeah, I don't believe there's a God.
Given your life had revolved around your faith, what did it mean for you to no longer have that belief?
I felt like my whole foundation was gone, and that caused a lot of unrest. My stability was gone. But then I was able to look at it freely and say it's actually really liberating. And so now I feel really liberated by not being stuck in that belief cycle.
Sherry, you were also born into the Jehovah's Witness faith. You both met at 19 and married 5 years later. When did you realise Sasha was questioning the religion you shared?
I didn't become aware until June 2015, when my husband runs a business, small business, and we were employing a Jehovah's Witness girl to help her. She had fossicked around on Sasha's computer and discovered that he had not logged out of an ex-Jehovah's Witness forum. So she realised through that, because she saw all of Sasha's comments, his posts, she went and told the elders and then resigned. And it was through her resignation and then learning that the elders knew about this that all of a sudden I was faced with the realisation that my husband was an apostate, that he no longer believed, and it was a pretty brutal way of finding out.
You'd been married for 16 years when Sasha told you he no longer believed in God. How did you feel about that?
I don't think I can possibly describe what that weekend felt like. our marriage had been based on this foundation of the religion. We had been very involved in the organisation. Both of us gave our youth to the organisation. To know that Sasha no longer believed, I was left wondering what our marriage was based on. Mm. It was terrifying, absolutely terrifying. And at the same time, I was aware of all of the implications and ramifications from the religion's point of view. Mm. And I could leave him and have the blessing of the religion to do that.
Sasha, you were tackling big issues. How did the conversation unfold?
Very slowly and very carefully. I was happy to share with her my research or what I'd found, but I also didn't want to put pressure on her, or I didn't want to force her to have to conform to my new worldview either. I respected Sherry's personal right to walk her own journey of faith. So I was careful what I shared, but I basically said to her, look, you know who I am. I'm still the same person, so ask me anything.
How was the mood during that conversation?
Oh, that's why I remember the date. It was definitely make or break because not knowing what our relationship was now sitting on, and Sasha was very honest with me, as honest as he could be. So to learn that he not only no longer believed in the religion, but now did not believe in the Bible and didn't believe in God, I was just dumbstruck at it.
So by staying with Sasha, you chose your husband over the church. Mm. What were the consequences of that?
Well, I was collateral damage. Walking in the street in an area where we'd been for 20 years, now all of a sudden I was being shunned. I just supported my husband and noticed as the days and the weeks and the months went by that no one from the congregation was actually interested in me at all. Mm. I was just collateral damage and was shunned from the local congregation pretty much straight away.
Did you grapple with that choice between your marriage and your beliefs?
Yes, I did grapple with it. The decision to stay with Sasha was pretty easy. That we had a good marriage. We'd been married 16 years. I couldn't think, contemplate the idea of leaving him over a religion or over a change in belief system. Mm. And I knew that in time, more and more of the people that we had known all of our lives, family included, would ostracise us. And that's what happened.
Janina, as well as being Emmy's mum, you're a clinical psychologist. Has your professional experience helped with your family rift?
It was very painful to have the estrangement. I did really turn over, do I fix this immediately? How do I go about this? Can we resolve this given our beliefs and our values differ so much? As a psychologist, I suppose I understand that we all have a certain amount of emotional capacity at any given moment, and that can change as we use coping strategies and we learn how to manage that. But at this point, I don't have the emotional capacity to be able to be calm and to deal with them in a way that would, I suppose, reconcile us. So I do feel that it is okay not to be in relationship with them at this point in time.
How did you make that decision to cut off contact with your parents?
Well, I think it was actually made for me because I wasn't wanting to cut off contact with them. I was wanting to limit contact. After they blocked me on social media, that was actually quite hurtful, and we were not able to resolve that. And it hasn't resolved since then.
Kurt, you're 37, and since you were a teenager, you've had clashes with your parents, including many periods of estrangement. We spoke to your mother, Gail, earlier. This is what she had to say about your relationship.
Kurt and I haven't always been on good terms. There have been periods in our life where there's been estrangement in the family, and he was missing. And then there were times that we didn't speak many years. Pole dancing is something that I've often thought that women did. There are areas where it borders on more erotic type stuff, and I've seen people lose relationships from being involved with this. Now, why I would be willing to look past that is that it is of huge value to me to have Kurt back in my life. Just really want to cultivate a relationship where there's mutual respect, each with our own boundaries, and work it through from there. Yeah.
Kurt, what's it like to hear that your mum does want to reconcile?
That has been one of the biggest things, especially because by the time I was able to talk to my parents and they got back to me, apparently my father shared a lot of those feelings, but he was no longer able to express them at the end of his life. And I don't know how to say this pain I carried almost all my life that's shaped my motivation to try to do good, and it all comes down to just someone being willing to look you in the eye.
Your father died earlier this year. Mm. What was your relationship like with him at the end?
I had a lot of worry about we just weren't addressing anything from the past. And I was trying to work out how to navigate that, or just accepting not to navigate that. And I got to see him playing with my son. I was there as he died. And the last thing we saw was a shared smile at joking about breaking him out of the hospital because he probably knows best. That was a big deal.
So you were on the path to reconciliation in a way.
或者是同性恋和异性恋，这是他爸爸讲的，找到一个安放身心的地方，好好的生活。真的，儿子、妈妈、爸爸，很遗憾的就是没有经历和你一起经历你最艰难的那段路程。Yeah,
I've been slashed by knives. My head was in a box with 12 stitches in my chin, 7 in my forehead, broken ankles, cracked ribs, ruptured eardrum.
What makes you keep going when you've nearly died?
It's just a natural thing to do.
Do you ever go back over that day and think, could we have done anything differently?
Daily. Instead of cracking jokes at his expense, maybe once just going, don't be a dickhead, you have a kid on the way.
I've been producing music and DJing for almost 20 years. It's taken me all around the world and I love doing it. There's quite a lot of drugs, and I got really caught up in the party drug scene, and it had a really negative effect on me, causing depression and anxiety for many years. I hit a real low point, but when I was 33, I had a spiritual experience and I found God. My name's Tim, and I'm a DJ and music producer. Christianity is an integral part of my life and my family's life. My faith 100% changed my attitude to life. I haven't touched drugs for nearly 10 years now. Becoming a father has also made big changes in my life. Now that I'm responsible for a little human being, I feel that I'm really growing as a person through being a father and a husband. I inherited my political views from my father, who, yeah, is typically left-leaning. And after I became a Christian, my values changed to a more conservative-leaning. I'm feeling quite disillusioned with the major political parties. There was a lot about their handling of the pandemic that I didn't like, so now I'm leaning more towards parties that espouse more conservative and traditional values.
Thank you for your generous provision with this meal. Amen.
Amen. There's been quite a lot of tension between me and my father around our political beliefs, especially during COVID. We had a lot of debates around lockdowns and vaccines and mandates, so it's caused quite a lot of tension in our family. Having these arguments and disagreements, I'd find that I was just thinking about these topics almost 24/7. It was stressing me out, affecting my home life and my work life. it really had a negative effect all around. My wife and I share our political beliefs, and there was a time during the pandemic we were not permitted to visit my parents in their home. We were also not allowed to go on a holiday with them that had been planned for a long time because we weren't vaccinated. So yeah, that was really, really hard to take and really sad. It was a strain on our relationship, but we were still communicating and talking on the phone.
Hey Dad, how's it going?
He was very accepting of me, regardless of my beliefs. So we've managed to maintain a good relationship, even though there's been some stresses.
Yeah, see ya. Bye.
Glenn, you're Tim's dad. How did you feel about your son's shift in values?
It was a challenge, particularly around all the contemporary issues.
Issues like?
Religion, politics, COVID, etc. It produced a lot of tension, but it offered some possibility of dialogue and debate as well.
Your relationship is still close. How do you navigate those differences?
Well, I think the fact that our relationship was close before this, you know, shift happened helped that, because you keep that memory of that close relationship in mind. And maybe the most important thing is not to make values, you know, you holding a particular value or belief, you know, disruptive of a connection, of a relationship, like family.
Does being a professional therapist come in handy?
Yeah, I think it does in many ways, because, and it's kind of really weird, you know, for me in a sense, because I was working with families, dealing with the same issues that was going on in my family at the same time, you know, around the COVID thing, about ruptures, you know, and religion. But I think it helps in terms of helping you to understand and take an attitude that is more empathic and less judgmental. I mean, therapy is all about curiosity, much like the show. It's about understanding through questioning, you know, through having dialogue and conversation. But at the same time, there are challenges, because the challenge really is to... I had to work out my position. I had to get to the point where I had to make a decision. No, I know what I believe. I'm not going to go there.
Janina, how has the relationship breakdown with your parents affected you?
It's devastated me. I'd like to think that I could work through that with them, but one of the things that keeps me from doing that is wanting to act very protectively for Emmy, and to ensure that my children, like, although we can hold different views and beliefs, sometimes those views and beliefs can be very damaging to other people, and that stops me from moving forward with that. I'm devastated that I can't have a close relationship with my parents at this point in time.
Can you see a point in time where there could be a reconciliation?
Absolutely. I accept their views and beliefs. I certainly don't want them to think exactly the same way as me. I think the world needs diversity. I mean, we live in a democracy. I absolutely want them in my life, but I want that mutual respect there so that we can, you know, exist together and be respectful of difference.
Emmy, what do you think about potentially reconciling with your grandparents?
I would love to see that in the future, because honestly, I do miss them. I've been able to talk to them properly for a long time now. I would love to see that happen in the future.
What does your mum's support mean to you?
It means so, so much to me. She's really helped me through all of these struggles after I've come out to her, and it's all just meant the world to me.
Isla, you're estranged from your adult child. How do you feel about them not wanting to discuss differences and find a way forward?
I think that I've tried to understand that reluctance in terms of her place within her peer group. And I think that to be a dissident within your own peer group, to even acknowledge that, in this case myself, that some of my views may have some validity, is very threatening to maintain status within the peer group. And certainly with my daughter, I fully understand her need to feel part of a bigger family, given that I don't have any and she was a single child. So I think that it's a bit like this lady was talking about and this gentleman over here about being an apostate in his church, in a sense, you know, for my daughter to affiliate, associate with a gender apostate as myself is dangerous territory to go into. And I should mention that I am from a left-wing background. I was raised in a family that talked religion, sex and politics, as I did with my daughter. And in many ways, we have very similar value systems. Where our value systems differ actually comes down to, if you like, a cultural diversity based on understandings to do with science, law and resolving conflicts of human rights.
Sherry, 18 months after Sasha renounced his faith, you also left the Jehovah's Witnesses. What's been the fallout from that?
Recognising or realising that the religion you'd given so much to was not true was devastating. I did go and seek help from a mental health professional. I felt enraged that I'd been lied to. I felt betrayed. I also felt like I'd lost that stability that I needed in life to identify who I was as an individual. So I felt very much like a cork bobbing along on the ocean with nothing to tether myself to. There were other implications too, obviously, with shunning, as my family began to realise that I was not going to return to the religion, I was leaving. Dealing with that fallout too was just another complicated layer.
Alex, for 2 years after you came out, your relationship with your mum was different.
Yep.
In what way?
I think it was very difficult to talk about the, you know, the topic was, you know, we decided to take nearly like 2 or 3 year cooling off period. And I think my mum was going through a bit of a journey herself. And, you know, I think I realised that I need to give her some time to think things through, to come to terms with it. And maybe the best thing to do is not to stir, you know, to make the situation worse, essentially. Yeah.
Si, you had always been very accepting of your son. What was it like seeing your wife struggle during this time?
那么虽然我能接受，但是呢，我考虑到，妻子这种状况，孩子这种状况，所以就感到很难受，很痛心。那么采取什么样的办法来去解决这个问题？我当时也是感到很困惑。
Where your son suggested that you reach out to a support group in China, how did that organisation help you?
然后他把我带到一个家长群里，那么就是在那个群里就是全部都是，因为当时我觉得身边就是我一个人，那就是我的孩子是这样，所以我觉得可怕。那后来呢，就是说他把我带到这个群里，那么我们这个群里就是大家都是，然后了解的这个性取向是自然的，是正常的，而且它是若干个国家已经是合法化了的。
In China, it's culturally not so acceptable to be gay. Has openly supporting your son been challenging?
困难肯定是有的，因为是，而且我在热线接热线的时候呢，也被骂，然后被说我们是一个传销组织，被说我们是给人家洗脑。
Wei and Si, your son Alex is in the room tonight. Is there anything you'd like to say to him?
我就希望其实 儿子和他的那个男朋友，就像我和他爸爸一样，我们今年是已经结婚40周年了，所以我也希望他们就是很幸福的，然后这样子的一起生活在一起，然后呢，我们这个家呢，也是这样子的，父母亲，然后我们真的很爱我的孩子，然后。
他的另外一半我也真的很感谢，因为这疫情接近三年了，所以说长时间的陪伴为我的孩子感到骄傲和自豪。他，我希望他在今后的生活当中能够一如既往的有这种韧劲，面对生活中的一切困难。 和同伴一起好好的生活，祝福他。无论是同性恋和异性恋，这是他爸爸讲的，找到一个安放身心的地方，好好的生活。真的，儿子、妈妈、爸爸，很遗憾的就是没有经和你一起经历你最艰难的那段路程，但是我相信你已经走过了。
Alex, how does it feel to hear those words from them?
I think now looking back, talking about the coming out journey, and my mom said it there, and she kept talking about she regrets that she couldn't be there for me when I need her the most, I guess. And I think, you know, I just keep telling my mom I'm so grateful that, you know, she's able to change her mind to see, you know, to see my side of the story, to be able to share the family that we have. And I'm just ever so grateful. I think she's done an amazing job to get to where she is and allow us to have this, enjoy the family that we have.
Mm-hmm. Alex, you haven't seen your parents for more than 2 years because of COVID, in person at least. Yeah. Are there any plans for a reunion soon?
Yeah, I'm hoping to get them to come over as soon as possible. I mean, China's still going through this COVID zero policy, so that hopefully next time we'll be able to, you know, join Mardi Gras as a family. Mm. Yeah.
Thank you so much. That's all we've got time for. Thank you so much for your time. Dateline is up next.